Now we go to the last technology of drying that we discussed together, infrared drying. Okay, again, this is the range of the radiation in life. It's a large range of radiation. It's called electromagnetic spectrum. Our eyes can see it is actually a small range of radiation. It's from 380 nanometer to 780 nanometer. And this is the range of radiation that we can see by our naked eyes. And then we combine all this together, we call this white light that from the sun, for example. But in reality, there are other radiations that we do not see. To this side, you go to the right, you reduce the wavelength, but you increase in frequency. Frequency, something like that. C is the speed of light in vacuum. Now we increase the frequency and then we increase a lot in energy. For example, here you have gamma rays in nuclear weapon, for example. And then for the X-rays in the hospital, for example, that the energy is very high, dangerous actually. Now, if we go to this side, we increase in the wavelength, so we reduce the energy of one photon of radiation. And here, visible light, this one is opposite of this one, okay? They draw it just opposite. So here we go to the left side. So we have ultraviolet, because our color in the visible light is from red, and this red here, sorry, red here, and then violet here. So when you go down below violet in frequency, you go up in frequency, you go down in wavelength, then you have this UV light. Okay, we call this UV light, ultraviolet light. In Vietnamese, cực tím or tử ngoại, and then you have X-ray, gamma rays. But you go to the right, you increase in the wavelength, you reduce in frequency. You have infrared here. Infrared là hồng ngoại. It's from red, now it's become infrared. And even in this range, they can classify and divide in three ranges: near infrared, mid infrared, and far infrared. Near is just near to the red, mid is a bit further, far is the most far from the right side. And we have radio, microwaves, length and radio, and so on, to further to the right. So these two are just opposite, you just look and compare. When you go to this, you do the sun bath in the beach. You go to the beach, you want to do sun bath yourself. And normally you apply some cream that to prevent this radiation from the sun, right? You are afraid of it. Because the radiation from this one to this, or from this one to the right here, is actually, we call this ionizing radiation. What does that mean? Because energy is high, which can remove, which can expel an electron from an atom, make it into an ion, can change the property of atom even. So the energy is high enough to do that, which may cause some influence, some damage to your cells, to the skin cells, change the color of the skin and so on. That's why you need to apply some cream to prevent this one to be absorbed in your skin. Okay, but the radiation from here to the right is called non-ionizing radiation. The energy is not high enough to make an atom into an ion. Heating mechanism of infrared. After the penetration into the food material, the infrared rays will vibrate the molecules, constituent molecules in the food at a frequency high like this. And the vibration will cause friction, intermolecular friction, friction among the molecules, and that will generate heat, internal heat, to heat up the food. Irradiation does not require any medium for its propagation. So if you here, you generate the irradiation, here you put your food can get hot, while the between here is an absolute vacuum. There is nothing in the middle, but the radiation can actually propagate both to the food. That is, you don't need a medium. So means that what? When you do this technology, you even don't need to heat the air. You can just propagate the radiation into food, right? The air doesn't need to be hot. Some vibration mechanism. So when we do high energy radiation, while we do microwaves, if you study already, microwaves radiation cause the rotation of molecule. The molecule will rotate left and right, left and right. That's called friction and generate heat. But in infrared radiation, the moving, the vibrate is not the same. It's kind of this direction, but not like rotation. What are the infrared radiation sources? So from where we can generate the infrared radiation? We can do it by electrically heating. We use electricity. Or we can just burn or fire the gas. There's two ways we can do. Okay, we can use electricity. For example, the incandescent lamps, is the lamp means that you use a current, electric current, that to generate, to burn, not burn, but how you call that? Just like, for example, is this like a bulb lamp in your house? Okay, that you generate the heat and that generate the light, and here you generate the heat by electricity, and that will generate the radiation. It will emit the infrared. There are several designs, several materials that they can apply to generate the radiation. For the gas, then they have to burn some gas. For example, this is a tube. If we can do it like that, they burn the gas inside the tube, for example, and then the surface here become hot, and this be hot surface will emit the infrared radiation outside. Then of course they have to design, they have to use certain material of this plate to emit the radiation. Not all kind can be possible. Now, when we use electricity, so the energy efficiency is higher. So we can focus the radiation in one direction more easily. But when we use a gas, so the efficiency of energy is lower, like you burn more gas to generate the same amount of radiation. This is, for example, operated by gas, and this is by electricity. It's like a lamp, actually. You have to apply electricity to both ends, and this looks like a lamp, but the color is red like this. It doesn't generate light like the bulb at your house, in your house, but it emits the radiation. And here you put the food, okay. And in this way, they use gas, and this is applied a lot in cold weather countries, like in Europe, for example. They have to burn the gas at the back somewhere here to generate at this side, so they can warm people in the factory. They warm people in big churches, for example, or people who have dinner outside, for example. Even in the winter, as the weather outside is very cold, 4 degrees C, but they may put some of it like this, and people just stand here to enjoy eating. Because the radiation will not hit the air a lot, but will propagate to human, and then it will make human warm. It does not need to warm the whole air, right? So this method is kind of suitable when you warm people even in the open space. You don't lose a lot of energy to the air. Or in the church, for example, if the church is so big and so tall and people are 16 here, if you heat all this air in the room, you lose a lot of energy. So yet they put this one on the top here, and then we just transfer the radiation to human below here. So you feel okay, right? Now we look at the radiation properties of material and its application. Absorptivity, transmissivity, reflectivity of the infrared radiation should be important and should be considered why we select the component to make the equipment or the drying chamber. Absorptivity means that when we just now project a radiation into a material like that, part of it will reflect, part of it will transmit, and part of it may be absorbed by the material. So for the food, then we need the food to absorb the radiation to generate heat. But for the drying chamber, you should, the material to make the drying chamber should not absorb the radiation. Otherwise, the chamber becomes very hot, not the food, right? So also it's important what material to make the drying facilities we have really take into account. And for the food constituents, then each molecule will have different range in wavelength for the absorption. The food constituent need to absorb the irradiation to convert it to heat by friction. Water absorbed in this band. And amino acids in protein, this band, the sugar, this band, the lipids, and this band. If we look at the water, water can absorb many bands of radiation, means that it's quite suitable the method to dry food, because food contains water, and we need to heat the water for the water to evaporate into vapor to remove the vapor. So this is an advantage that water can absorb the infrared radiation easily. Now we talk a little bit about penetration depth. What is penetration depth? If you have a material like this, and then you project into a radiation, infrared radiation, and then the radiation will now penetrate into the food, but how far it can go into the food? Here in the surface, then the energy is maximum, okay? For example, here, if we look at the radiation intensity, like the power at the surface is high, but you go further into the product, the energy of the radiation will be lower and lower, right? When it's lower to E value, E10, right? When the energy go down, by E value, E is 2.7 something. So when you have now 37%, 2 point something here, 30% of the surface intensity. So this is called penetration depth. If the radiation can move deeper and deeper into the food, means that you can dry the thick slices of the product. But if the penetration is too small, then you cannot heat homogeneously, evenly the thick food. Then you can only dry very thin. So penetration depth is also important. Thin food should have high absorptivity. Thin food should absorb the energy highly, so it will not transmit through the material. It will convert into heat more efficiently. Thick slice should have higher transmissivity, mean thick food can let it penetrate higher into the center. What are the influencing factors which will influence the penetration depth? Composition of the food, of course. The physical chemical state of the irradiated medium, like either solid, liquid, or vapor. The properties of food, like density, porosity, water content, also influences, and the wavelength of the incident radiation, the wavelength of the infrared radiation. And like this, if you remember, infrared radiation is not a single wavelength, it's a range of wavelengths. So depending on the sources, the material that you make to generate the infrared radiation, the range of length can be smaller or larger, or can be specific in some range, in some bands. Now, we go to the next part, application of infrared and infrared-assisted drying. Infrared drying means you only use infrared to do drying. Infrared-assisted drying means you use something else to dry, like hot air, like free drying, but you use infrared to help it, to assist it to have better drying. Now, infrared drying, here you have the tray, you put your food, and here you put the infrared lamp that generate the radiation of infrared that propagate into the food, and that heat the food, evaporate into vapor, and of course you need some air moving that to bring this vapor away. Okay. Infrared drying is faster than natural drying, sun drying, vacuum drying, freeze drying, and hot air drying. Then it's faster than conventional or normal drying technology, but it's still slower than microwave drying. Microwave, if you remember, the wavelength is higher than the wavelength of infrared. Be to the right. Infrared drying was also found efficient in retaining of antioxidant activity and nutraceutical composition of some dry products in a number of studies. So if you can optimize the system very well, then it's maintained better the bioactivity of the component, the sensorial, the quality of the product. Of course, if you can optimize it well, we also have this system at our factory. We have the heat pump drying system, we have the infrared drying system as well, but this is actually kind of difficult to optimize. We'll look further why it's difficult. We already know a bit exactly the composition of the food we influences, the thickness of the food, the water content of the food, and many other factors. Well, even the properties of the food is influenced by temperature. It's not the same. Or when the food becomes drier, the property is also changed. So it can absorb or transmit the radiation differently. Infrared drying saves energy because you don't need to heat the air to dry food. In the other technology, you have to heat the air and the air transfer the heat to food. But here you do directly from the source of the radiation to the food. You don't need to heat the air. Irradiation may kill, actually it can kill insects. And it can kill some microorganism and insect, because the insects are also living material. Microorganism also, they have water, they have protein, they have fat inside. So they may absorb the radiation and then it heated their body and they may die. So some company, they use infrared radiation to kill the insect in factory, in restaurant, in hotel, in some rice factory machine, for example. There's quite some kind of insect, even in hotel, they can use this to just work for a while to kill the insect. The major operating parameters to be optimized. So if you want to optimize the system, these are what you need to look for, the parameters you look for. You look for temperature, the intensity of the infrared radiation. Okay, intensity. If you put one lamp or if you put three lamps, you have more intensity. When you have more intensity, then you can increase the temperature and so on. And this is also important, the distance between the product surface and the heating element. So here you should have not so far distance. If it's too far, the heat transfer is radiation transfer is also not good. The thickness of the product is also important because this is related to the penetration depth, and this is determined by the absorbability of the material, the transmittability of the material as well. The exposure or the drying time, how long you should dry as well, is important. Now we go to infrared acidic hot air drying. Meaning you just use hot air drying, but you use infrared to acid the conventional drying. You have it a little bit. Here you heat the air, and you heat the air, you introduce the air to dry the food. And in the drying chamber, you install the infrared lamp to give some extra radiation to the food. And here, if you do normal hot air, then what? The heat from the air will transfer to the product, but transfer to the surface first, right? But if you use infrared lamp, the radiation may be absorbed a little bit inside the surface, right? Depending on the penetration depth, the radiation can go inside. Why the conventional air will just go from outside in? Now, this can be inside. And it generates the heat inside. It will increase the vapor pressure of water inside. And then even water can evaporate inside like this, and then can move out faster. Then you increase the mass transfer of the drying. It's have, or you can have other technology that infrared radiation can assist, like infrared assisted vacuum drying. This one, okay. So now in vacuum drying, you just you heat the air inside. In normal, then you heat to 60, but in vacuum drying, maybe 50 is enough, because when you reduce the pressure, remember, you reduce the saturated water pressure, means you reduce the boiling point of water. Reduce the pressure in the surrounding, you make it more easy for the water to evaporate, so you don't need to increase high temperature like in hot air. And here you also introduce the extra infrared to give the radiation to the food even. So your vacuum is already have advantages compared to normal hot air drying. Now you increase this, then you can do the heating faster, you dry it faster. And when you do dry it faster, when you shorter the time, you shorter the time means that you can preserve better nutritional and sensorial quality. Time is crucial, not only the temperature, remember. Right. And then here we can combine with freeze drying even. This is freeze drying. Normally freeze drying, you work at high vacuum, you work at freezing temperature, but here you even put the lamp to heat it up faster. Or here they use infrared lamp to support the microwave drying. Microwave that is generated from the magnetron, and then the microwave be absorbed into the food and heat the food very fast. Now they use infrared to even absorb it very fast. Microwave and infrared is kind of the same heat transfer mechanism. You don't need an environment to transfer the heat. You don't need to heat the air, right? So if you use a microwave at home, you put the food inside and you warm the food. You put your hand after that into to take the food out. You don't feel that the air is hot, actually only the food is hot. But if you use a normal oven, the oven have to heat the air first. The air very hot, and then to heat the food. And you have to, when you after using it, you have to wait for a long time for the oven to cool down. But for microwave, no need, because the air is not heated. Microwave transfer, infrared transfer is kind of the same, but microwave is called the rotation of the molecule, and this one called the vibration like this of the molecule. It's just different heat generating mechanism. Yes, what are the challenges when we apply infrared radiation in food? Infrared radiation has a low penetration depth in general. Low means you can only be used for thin slices of food. If you thick, then you have to combine with other drying technology like hot air, like vacuum, and so on. Non-uniform drying, this is a critical issue. If the food material is dry on multiple layers, so if you put many layers of food, and if you put the lamp here, okay, and the radiation will just transfer to the third layer, second layer, but here, no, not a lot, because this one will prevent already. So the drying is not evenly. So you have to change the trays time to time. This is actually so laboring, difficult for the laborers, people to work. A big challenge to optimize the IR intensity or the temperature in order to minimize the color and microstructure degradation or to reduce the bonding of the sample. The wavelength of IR to be used need to be very specific because each food component has a specific absorption band, like water in wet band, lipid in wet band. But one good thing for us is water can absorb the irradiation in several bands, a large range. Anyhow, there are challenges, but there are also advantages. That is why they apply. That's why we also invested in this system. This is difficult, but if we understand everything, if we do some experiment that to optimize it, then we can do, and then we have some extra good things about the food that we can obtain. Now, these are the documents for the content of the chapter. We have this. Actually, I base a lot on this book, Introduction to Food Engineering, Paul Seid. I haven't met him in person yet, but I use a lot from his book, so I really appreciate if he has a chance to listen to what I'm talking. And then there are other books as well, only in for the infrared drying part, then you look at this material. And several images from other book and some experience from my old working, researching and processing and so on. So, thank you very much for cooperating for a long chapter, very long chapter. And you can look at the channel again. All the courses there as well. What I teach, I put there. Time to time, if you need to review again, when you work in industry, you need to understand the principle again before you can apply something else, then go here and a lot of good information to explore.